Salutations, my macroscopically inclined friends, and welcome back to How Dirty Is with me, your equally macroscopic host. Today, we shall be venturing on a journey into the realm of the very small to bring light to some of the coolest little critters you may not have even known existed. We live our lives surrounded by creatures so tiny we can't see them with the naked eye. While that may not be the most comforting thought, it is most certainly an interesting one. And seeing as comfort is the enemy of growth, I simply insist that we buck up together and dive headfirst into the top 5 coolest microorganisms. Let's go. Number 5, tardigrades. Clocking in at number 5, our first critter is the iconic tardigrade. This adorable microorganism goes by other names such as the water bear or moss piglet, but don't let these adorable titles fool you. This is one of the most resilient life forms on the planet. While they most certainly would prefer to be munching on some grub in the water, they can handle some of the most extreme environments life can throw at them. They can survive temperatures of nearly absolute zero up to 150 Celsius, pressure of nearly 400 atmospheres, being stored in a freezer for 30 years. Not really sure who tested this, but, you know, good for them. They can handle being shot from a gun, also. Not sure why someone tested that, but okay. These hardy hogs can even stand the UV radiation of space. Why do they need to be so tough? I really don't have a clue, but when their time comes to rule over the domain of man, I want to be on their side. Number 4, dust mites. The next on our fabulous friends list is the admittedly kind of gross dust mite. These funky fellas are a type of microscopic arachnid that belong to the same family as spiders, scorpions, and ticks. Now you may be wondering, did I just insinuate that your abode might have invisible spiders crawling around? I did. You're welcome. And it is reasonable to just torch the whole place and live in a bubble? Well, probably not. Exaggeration aside, these are actually mighty helpful critters. They feed off dead skin cells left behind by people and other animals, as well as other organic material. Without dust mites, we might find ourselves wading through a sea of dead skin, so having them around seems like a reasonable compromise to make. While they are harmless to humans, dust mites can trigger allergies to those sensitive to them. Proteins in their feces, yes, they are pooping in your house too, are known allergens. Symptoms can include sneezing, itching, a runny nose, and sometimes visible rashes. And to keep on top of this involves regular cleaning of carpets and other fabric surfaces. A low humidity environment is important too, as the dust mites love humidity. As long as you wash yourself and your stuff regularly, clean up clutter, these small spiders should pose very little issue. Number 3, slime molds. Third is our slimy synonym for a pal, the slime mold. Such an appealing name, isn't it? These odd creatures don't fit into the biological kingdoms of animal, plants, or fungi. Instead, they belong to the lesser known protista kingdom, which feels like I'm reading out of a Game of Thrones map or something. Slime molds are amoeba-like in their movement, which is a sort of flowing motion over surfaces. There are two primary types of slime molds, plasmoidal and cellular slime molds. Plasmoidal slime molds fold a large multinucleate mass called plasmodium, which moves and feeds by engulfing organic matter. This large mass is visible to the naked eye and looks something like this. Kinda nasty looking, right? The other type is a cellular slime mold, which exists as an individual amoeba-like cells. They can aggregate into multicellular structures when they release chemical signals, forming fruiting bodies that can produce spores. But the neatest thing about slime molds isn't that they look like a bad sneeze. It's actually their unique ability to problem solve. When they're placed in a maze, slime molds use their protoplasmic network towards foods, and they abandon the least useful routes to get to food. And slime molds have actually been used in recent years to build biocomputers. Yeah, you heard right. Living computers. Sweet, right? Man-made horrors beyond my comprehension. All in our lifetime. Aren't we just so lucky? Number 2, Demodex mites. I am totally serious. Face mites. Not quite as awful as what you would find in Alien, but the concept is still alarming. These tiny mites live in the hair follicles and oil glands on people's skin. In fact, most people have a few of these guys on their skin. They're considered part of normal skin flora and do tend to be more numerous on older individuals. Sorry, Grandpa. In a somewhat alarming turn, they tend to spend most of their time living on their host's face, mainly cheeks, noses, eyelashes, and forehead. Scraping out their humble existence as face livers, these microscopic mites feed off of sebum and dead skin cells that are naturally produced throughout the day. Then they meet their soulmate and lay eggs in your hair follicles. Isn't that just romantic? The average lifespan of the mites is usually a few weeks, a fleeting, yet beautiful life, all played out on a microscopic scale, all planted firmly on your face. Really is romantic. Thankfully, these mites tend not to cause any issues with humans, and in cases of immunocompromised adults, an overabundance of mites might lead to some skin issues like rashes and inflammation. Number 1. Vampire amoebas. First off, beep the new fit. Vampire amoebas, because the realm of blood-sucking horrors is not just for larger organisms. I'm afraid that at just about every size, something is eager for blood. These amoebas would do Dracula proud by continuing on with his lovely tradition. Vampire amoebas are obligate parasites, which means they rely on their host for nutrition. Fortunately, they tend to go for algae and other microorganisms and not people. Amoebas have a pseudopodia, which is a false foot that they use to get around their environment. These microorganisms has a specialized pseudopodia that is long and slender and perfect for penetrating cell walls. Once they poke a hole in their prey, they make a vacuum with this tube and drain the cell of its... well, it's everything, really. And naturally, when the cell is drained of its cytoplasm, organelles, nucleus, and, well, everything, the host cell dies. Fear not, though. This micro monster has no interest in humans, prefers to pick on something its own size. And there you all have it. Five of some of the strangest microorganisms that might just be watching the video with you right now. Shout out to them, and of course, shout out to you, dear viewer. Always a pleasure to have you on board. If you enjoyed the video or any of my other videos, please feel free to like, subscribe, comment. If you hated it, you can let me know in the comments too. Consider subscribing to my second channel, Stranger Than Science, if you want to listen to some spooky oopy narrations of some creepy stories, something I enjoy immensely. And if you're feeling extra generous, also consider becoming a member, and I can put your name in the credits, because I don't really have any end credits right now, so I need them. And thank you again for joining me on this wonderful journey, and I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.